Welcome to this IT4IT track, which is all about managing the business of IT. So we're going to talk about or zoom into IT management. My name is Rob Akershoek. I'm the chair of the IT4IT forum. And since the introduction of the IT4IT reference architecture, we see a lot of interest in it. And that's not surprising, considering all the challenges that most IT organizations are facing today. Just think about it. We have to deliver faster, reduce the cost, eliminate risks, and at the same time, improve transparency and traceability in the IT function. But more important, give the business control over the outcome on IT. And at the same time, as you heard this morning, we have to implement new ways of working, such as continuous delivery, agile development, DevOps, just to mention a few. Now, most IT organizations realize that they need to fundamentally change the way they run and manage their IT, and that they need to transform to enable the digital enterprise. Now, the good news is that IT4IT, the IT4IT reference architecture, provides you the guidance to implement that journey and to modernize your IT function. This afternoon, we will have three presentations on IT4IT, but we start off with a panel discussion. So I'm very glad that we have all the keynote speakers from this morning available on the panel. It's a little bit hot here, but I guess we will survive. So I would like to welcome you. So it's very nice being here. So Charles Betz, active member of the IT4IT forum. We've got Gene Kim. Well, we don't need a further introduction. We all have the book lying around here. Bernard Golden and David Wheable and David Cannon. Thank you for being here. It's a pleasure. But we also got some additional IT4IT specialists in the room that potentially, if the debate allows, we will have some further discussion. So Mike Fulton from Nationwide, our vice president of the IT4IT forum, or vice chair, I must say. We got also Lars. Is Lars in the room? He's not there. And Mark Botman from ServiceNow, potentially also. We will ask some questions and zoom into that. Okay. Now, the format for this afternoon is we have identified a number of themes we'd like to discuss. And we have organized some questions around that. And so one of the key topics is, and I'll start with that, is automation of the IT organization. So that's one of the topics, and the role of architecture within the IT organization, specifically IT management architecture. We're going to talk about DevOps and what does that mean for your IT operations, IT function, the way we organize things. And potentially, if the times allow us, we have some relationship with transforming the IT organization, getting the business and IT more together. This was one of the topics of this morning's presentation. Now, the format is we will ask some of the questions, and at the end of each theme, we have the possibility for you to ask additional questions. So just raise your hand, and I will give you a microphone. We have to, looking at the number of people on the stage, we have to look at the timing as well. So let's see how much interaction with the audience we can get, but feel free to, after each item, to jump in. Okay? Thanks. So let me start with the first theme, that's about automation. So now, I understand DevOps is all about culture and people, but I still want to talk about tools, if that's okay with you, because we still see that automation of IT activities is a key activity within the IT function. But if you look at how IT is managed today, you see a lot of manual activities still, and a lot of spreadsheets. So what we're interested in is, how important is for you, Gene, specifically, how important do you think is automating your IT activities across the value stream and the different value chains? How important is automation? Because you mentioned in your presentation as well, if you don't automate, for example, test, maybe also deployment monitoring, you're building legacy from the start. So we'd like to get your opinion on automation and importance in the value streams.
Yeah, I think what the studies show is quite conclusive. I mean, there's really three factors needed to get these amazing outcomes that we talked about. One is architecture, right? Enable loosely coupled, something sufficiently loosely coupled to enable small teams to independently develop, test, and deploy value to the customer. That's one. Number two is technical practices, right? So that's broadly speaking, would probably include automation, whether it's testing, deployment, environment creation, and so forth. And then third is cultural norms. And it is like I think off the top of my head, the top seven things that predict performance are version control, automated testing, high trust cultural norms, production monitoring, something else, right?
Deployment automation.
All of those require automation to some degree. So it's extremely important, but certainly not, it's necessary, but not sufficient.
Right. And maybe related to that, there is some organizations, they say our strategy is to automate everything. And it's maybe for Bernard, for you, because organizations that move to the cloud typically have the ability to do that from the start. So how do you see, is it a good strategy to say we automate everything from day one?
From day one.
If you introduce a new application in the cloud, for example.
I think for sure, if you say, I'm going to use that whiz-bang cloud provider, and I'm going to use the same kind of processes I've had all along, you're probably not going to have optimal outcomes. And you may actually have worse outcomes, because as I mentioned in my presentation, you know, Amazon's number one rule is everything fails all the time. Mm-hmm. So the assumption is the underlying infrastructure is not resilient. You have to figure out how to put that into your application, not assume it from the infrastructure, which is the traditional assumption has been, I put in a server and it runs forever. And anytime it breaks down, it's like, well, that was an exception to the thing rather than the rule. So if you say, I've got to figure out how to put resilience into the application, that means I'm going to be repeatedly doing things. I've got to automate it. So I think you have to do that if you want to get the value. Otherwise, you've just sort of, you know, you've started to use something that's really great, but shoved it into the, you know, it's like buying a brand new huge engine and putting it into an old beat up jalopy, and then going, how come I can't run the Nürburgring as fast as BMW does? Well, because you haven't got the whole car.
Okay, thank you. And then Charlie, related to it, how do you think IT4IT can help you enabling what was just discussed, the automation across the value stream? How important is IT4IT for that?
Well, let me just briefly address what was some of the previous as well. I think one of the most interesting works on automating all the things is the Google Site Reliability Engineering work. There's a book by O'Reilly, an O'Reilly book, Betsy Beyer edited it. And they go into details on what Google thinks should be automated and should not be. They've got a whole set of criteria as to when they choose to automate. And so there's actually a taxonomy and a whole decision process you need to go through. In general, high variability work that is performed infrequently, not a great candidate for automation. But you have to think about it in terms of those kinds of, you know, spectrum issues.
Can I just share one story that please. I just thought was so provocative? So, you know, the Chaos Monkey is very sexy, right? It's like, oh my gosh, they're randomly rebooting servers. One of the most interesting stories I got from one of the reviewers was this problem they have, right? The biggest problem they have is they can't patch servers because they're afraid that it will never come back up again. So what they did was they basically emailed everybody and said, I'm going to reboot your servers sometime this week, you know, in about a month, get ready, right? And you know, they actually showed the mean time to finish rebooting went from days to hours to minutes just by announcing that we're gonna reboot servers sometime, right? Yep. And suddenly our ability to patch, you know, our confidence to do that went through the roof. And I just love it because it's so pedestrian, it's so fundamental, and yet, you know, we still love the servers that haven't been rebooted for 8 years, right? And yet that's exactly the behavior we don't want in mission-critical refineries, say, right?
Force them to think about these kind of things up front.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But to your question, so automation is an interesting concept, and part of the problem is that a lot of the automation that we've been talking about, especially like with Bernard and so on, is kind of, I consider it kind of under the line of IT4IT. You're getting down into, you know, API level things, and IT4IT doesn't really play there. IT4IT is more about human to machine, human to human automation, as opposed to machine to machine automation. And I could probably go down a rabbit hole that I don't think we want to go down right now on that one.
Yeah, but for example, you mean the end-to-end traceability, if there's a new thing in the backlog, some people modify the code, it's built, tested, deployed, the end-to-end chain, you can bring the data together across the value streams.
Yeah.
Not necessarily, not only automation, it's more providing the insight and getting the data linked to each other.
Yeah, and IT4IT kind of operates at a meta level with some of the R2F stuff. It just says you should have an API, you should have a process. But boy, to specify all those, we'll be starting with what Bernard showed for the Amazon services and blowing that out. Yeah. I mean, that's not IT4IT's intent.
So David Cannon, for you, you talked about business strategy and IT strategy. Have you seen a place where on the board, where you talk about strategy, also IT management strategy is discussed? So for example, typically the CIOs or the executive level, they're not interested in the tools or the automation we use. Do you see that as a topic? If automation is important, would that be something that you will discuss more strategically as well?
I don't know that I've seen that many discussions on the board around this. Quite frankly, I think most boards don't really care how you do it. They really care that you're doing it as cost-effectively and as consistently as possible. And to that end, obviously, automation is something that a CIO would be wanting to get behind. The question, though, is to automate something, you really have to understand it. And that's one of the issues. Not only do you have to understand it, but it has to be so repeatable and so frequent within the organization.
Exactly.
Yeah, that means maybe you need to rethink the way you organize your work.
Right, and so I don't see
those.
You don't
want a legacy process to be automated.
Those discussions around managing IT don't tend to happen at board level.
I'll give you a counterexample that I find very inspiring. Richard Fairbanks, the CEO of Capital One, has gone on record saying numerous times that in order for us to win in the marketplace, we are building a world-class technology organization.
Right.
The CEO of ING Bank, same thing. And so, you know, these are organizations that have 8,000, 10,000, I'll call them engineers, dev, test, ops, security people. And so I think that's a declaration, right? That
you would imagine, indeed, if the business says our strategy is that IT is part of our business, they need to think about how they manage that, right? The underlying way of working. And then it is a question, is there a need to standardize that way of working before you can automate? But do you see that practice happening?
Well, we see it happening more on the front end.
Yeah.
If you were to ask, are boards discussing how they can automate interactions with customers? Absolutely. Are they discussing what do we do in the back office to make our IT more cost efficient? I'm not sure.
Yeah,
but
it's too
much of that.
Yeah, but if IT is at the front end, suddenly you need to manage that as a business capability potentially, meaning you need to think about how you manage IT across the life cycle. So potentially then, the IT management discussion will come back in the strategy, right? Often.
Yeah. This may seem like a minor thing, but you know, when we came out with the Phoenix project, we actually changed one word. I've changed my talk titles. I've changed all references to IT to technology,
right?
Because it's almost like IT is like MIS, and it's like how I get my new laptops. But you know, it's like you say, it's about world-class technology organizations. I mean, it's has a different context about how quickly can I get my laptop from the help desk.
Maybe a question for you, David.
You raised something. You said help desk, so that raised something for me in terms of technology.
Because everyone knows, I tell people, we'll never give up the help desk. That's all they care about. We've known each other for a long time.
What's interesting about help desk is exactly what you're saying. The trend in help desk now is to move from break fix to being more of business support. And so, for example, when a user calls you and says, I need something from you, technology, used to be, I need you to fix this. Increasingly, it's, I'm trying to use this to do that. Am I doing it the best way? Do you know of some app or some technology that can do it better? And this really started to come to the fore when we started talking about genius bars and concierge bars, something that most organizations were not prepared for. They thought it would be a walk-in break fix. Instead, it became a tech advisory center. Mm-hmm. And that's a really good example of where the technologists are getting engaged in the front lines of business. Now, again, that doesn't necessarily translate into what I automated in the back office. So.
Yeah, but it's partially maybe self-service, self-help to the business. And then if they really have a question that is rooted not to a service desk, but rooted to the person that can answer that question immediately.
Well, right. This is what you're doing through automation. What you're doing is you're taking the routine activities, you're taking the things that are easy to handle, the things that are well understood, you're commoditizing them, automating them, so that your technical staff can focus on the really high value activities of what it takes to make this business competitive and run better than anything.
Now, a question for David Wheable. So one of the challenges we see with a lot of IT organizations, they're going to source IT services to a number of vendors. So you have a multi-vendor ecosystem, each using their own processes, their own tools, their own terminology, and their own way of working. So what do you see as an opportunity to have better interoperability between all these vendors by having a standard such as IT4IT, such as defining how you can integrate and interoperate with multiple vendors across the value chain? So how do you see that?
It's relevant for almost every organization I talk to at the moment. They've gone from the stage of just using internal services now to integrating internal and external services. As architectures also become more granular with microservices, you're actually getting the situation where you want those individual teams to use the best tools available to manage the product that they are responsible for. So there has to be an integration layer. Now, what that means in terms of some of the tools and some of the interactions, we're going from effectively build time complexity to runtime complexity. Therefore, how you understand what is happening live in the production environment with all the interactions and integrations becomes important. So standards and common language then allow you to be able to effectively and efficiently to be that runtime integrator of all these disparate services that you're going to consume. But I wouldn't say it's just multi-supplier. It's actually treating the internal IT in the same way. So if you have a product team that's responsible for a particular set of microservices, then they are treated in the same way as the external vendor.
Right. But you could see that currently, if you consume market services, each vendor, and there's probably a question for you, Bernard, is that each of the vendors, like Amazon and Azure, they provide management tools with them and management APIs and management capabilities. But in a sense, they're proprietary because they're linked to their capabilities. How do you see that in the future? Is there a more need to that I can consume market services using standards, or will you always have each vendor competing with their own APIs to deliver that specific service they offer?
Well, so it's not that there's a sense that they're proprietary. They are proprietary, there's no question. And they tune those to deliver as much value as they can for their particular set of services, which are, you know, unique to them. Well, let me answer your question in a different way. I was approached by a company that said, we would like you to come join us and help define a standard for APIs and management of cloud providers, and we want you to work with the cloud providers to put this together and so that we can deliver value to, you know, end users and all that. And I said, well, that's fine, but that would be like pushing on a rope, because while you might like it, the cloud providers, there's nothing, you know, there. Maybe there's a sort of a patriotic kind of, yeah, that would be great to do, but there's no practical value for them. And if anything, they see it as sort of interfering with their ability to innovate. So, you know, my reaction was thanks, but no thanks. I don't want a job where basically I'm knocking on doors and people saying, get out of here.
Right.
So I think it's quite challenging. And I've been at two companies that was basically our value proposition. We're gonna figure out a way to, you know, provide a homogeneous layer across heterogeneous stuff to make it better for IT. Mm-hmm. And the thing that we kept breaking our pick on was we were not able to expose enough of the functionality that those providers offered, and we ended up with the lowest common denominator.
Exactly, you can order a virtual machine in a database, right? Everybody has that, but then you can build up on top of that, or you really leverage their serverless computing, which is different for each vendor.
I think that's, you know, a dilemma that there is no convenient solution for,
right?
Unfortunately.
Closing down the topic of automation, is there any additional question from the audience? Or maybe, Mike, additional comments on this? Yeah?
One question. As part of the MBA program, I studied production science and production engineering. Okay? I've never seen those models, practices, disciplines mapped across to IT. And maybe you guys have, but I
think he wrote a book on it.
It's a really interesting. So I'm familiar, I wouldn't say that I've studied the disciplines, but I'm actually familiar with the question, and it's been preoccupying my mind for the last 10 years or so. IT and digital is primarily R&D. Software is thought. That's straight from Alistair Coburn. And so as thought, it is an R&D process. And when you try to mix too much production engineering thinking into it, you get into dead ends like the capability maturity model, which was based on the premise of statistical process control for software development, and I think has been resoundingly rejected by history. So that's not to say we can't learn from. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. You know, on the other hand, are there things we can learn from production thinking and production engineering? That absolutely has come into the digital movement via Lean and DevOps, via the work, for example, that Gene has done bringing in the perspectives of Eli Goldratt into the DevOps production pipeline. But you have to be very, very clear on your variability domains. And when you go looking at the high variability development and R&D processes, well, Don Reinertsen, he loves to tell the story of the Lean Six Sigma engineers in there pestering the research and development engineers, saying, oh, well, the problem that your R&D program has is that your engineers are putting their staplers in inconsistent places on their desktops. And so we're going to solve the R&D problems by putting tape around where they should put their stapler. True story, it happened. So
50% increase in productivity.
Yeah, exactly. And then there was the guy who wanted a banana on his desk for half the day, and that took a week to resolve. You know, so I'm sorry if that, you know, it's a really interesting conversation.
But, in your book, what I loved about it was, I mean, you made a very, I would say almost like an isomorphic mapping between bill of materials and routings and loadings and, you know, lead times. And, you know, I remember being just dazzled by that in terms of, you know, how would you run part of the value stream in that kind of mechanistic world. And I think testing and operations is very amenable to that. And
it is.
By the way, the value for, like, how do you go from, if you measure lead time by how quickly can you go from a requirement to a feature to whatever, I mean, there's so much value to be gained there, right? Just because even where there is variability.
But it's a variable process, and at the risk of, and I'll shut up and you can, like, not call on me for a little bit, but one of the seminal moments in the creation of Scrum, and there's a story there, a lot of people know about Sutherland, getting involved with Nonaka and the lean product paradigm. People will say that's where Scrum came from. But the other half of it was Ken Schwaber's experiences at DuPont, where he came in as a consultant with, I think it was Ernst & Young or Deloitte, one of those, and they had the big methodology, like at Accenture we had the business integration methodology. And he ran into some real process control engineers, including a guy named Babatunde Ogoneke, who wrote one of the definitive texts in the field you're talking about. And what Schwaber said, the quote is epic, rarely have I provided a group with so much hilarity. Because he came in with this flowchart of how they were going to do software development, and these real process control engineers said, you are engaged in pseudoscience. You know, there is no way that you can apply our techniques of process control to such a variable process. The only process control mechanism that will work is empirical process control. And so that's the great historical narrative, CMM trying statistical process control, Scrum ultimately triumphing in the market with empirical process control. That's where we are historically. I'll be quiet and you can not call on me now for the next one.
Yeah, let's do that. I changed microphone here. So we want to talk about architecture, so the next topic, specifically IT management architecture. Now, let me set the scene. Most larger IT organizations, they don't have a vision or a strategy for IT management, right? They have different tools in place for the same function, or they let development people select their own development tools and operations tools, and you can imagine there's a whole set of processes, tools, repositories, spreadsheets, custom build solutions, and so on. Now, one of the key challenges that we face is how do we do it? One, do we want to standardize that, and how do you create that standardization of processes and tools within the IT organization? So I want to start with David Wheable about this. Specifically, you mentioned service architecture. So what is your idea and opinion of that, and how can we leverage that architecture for IT management?
I think it's an area that needs more development. That's certainly there. I suppose it's difficult to say. One of the challenges I have with a lot of IT management software at the moment is fundamentally it's fairly basic, to be honest. There's been automation done in lots of ways, but we don't actually exploit the technology we use for business into IT management. So taking the favorite service desk, help desk ticketing system, it really hasn't moved much on beyond the paper system. It really is about moving bits of paper around. If it ever goes wrong, you could fundamentally replace it with paper and it'll be slower, but that's all. So one of the challenges I think for this sort of new world as we get more complex architectures and we have these much greater digital interactions is actually understanding the better ways of managing and governing and operating the software that we are deploying and actually starting to use those technologies that are coming out now that allow us to do that better. So, you know, using AI, using the changes in some of the other technologies that we can actually build out. So a lot more understanding of the environment built in, a lot more causality, actions, and so on. So using machine learning to pick up patterns. That's where I think that has to go. And we have to start really thinking that there is a value in that management of IT environment.
Right. Yeah, so I think people recognize the value, but there's a further question for Gene about this. But how do you think, how important is IT management architecture for the IT function? Or do you leave each development or agile team select their own source code system, test system?
Oh, God help us. No.
Because that's typically a practice today, right?
Well, the room for improvement is so vast, right? Yeah. And maybe just to characterize this, as much as I love making fun of architects I would aspire to be an architect in a different life. It has been such an overly delegated function, right? I mean, like, one of the key learnings for me, what I was trying to get across in the Etsy example with the Sprouter, is that, like, how can you make organizational design decisions without first incorporating the architectural implications? And for me, I just think about, like, there's certain industries, like hospitality, where they still routinely outsource development to one group, outsource tests to another, outsource ops to another group, and then information security to yet another one, right? And the theory is, you know, they all keep each other accountable and so forth. But I mean, you talk about in a world where speed matters more than cost, right? I mean, you cannot come up with a worse configuration to get anything done, right? And so anything we can do to arm executives and IT management with, like, you know, here's how we organize and think about flow in this new world, who's going to help them if not the architects?
Yeah, so you kind of mentioned that you basically need an IT managed architecture to guide that value stream implementation process and tools, but...
Can I tell a funny story? Yeah. Just, this is tragic, but hopefully you'll see the comedy in it. A friend of mine, he's like an IT director in a large hotel chain. And, in this hotel like this, there are three Wi-Fi networks. There's the guest Wi-Fi, events Wi-Fi, and then there's probably corporate Wi-Fi, right, where all the back office systems are. And some bean counter said, you know what, we have three network switches, let's put them all in one, right? You know, better accountability, you know, better cost control, better support contracts, whatever. What they didn't realize was each one of those three network switches had three different outsources on it. So they put them all on one switch, and within days, they were locking each other out of the accounts, till one day, like, the link between the point of sale systems and the restaurants and the ERP systems broke. And no one would accept responsibility for it. It went on for 4 weeks, went to the CEO of a multi-billion dollar hotel organization, four CEOs of multi-billion outsourcers, right? No one admitted failure for that. But it's just, we took a simple working system where there was no interaction, and for whatever reason, management and architects, you know, we allowed ourselves to get into a situation where now you had everything that was talked about, need to communicate, coordinate, prioritize, whatever, do a denial service on everybody. It's just, does anyone think that's a little bit funny? I mean, like, terrible? I mean, does that resonate with any stories in your own history?
I think I stayed in that hotel.
Yeah, right. Just, I find that so maddening. So it's like, if we can help management make better decisions.
But in a way, I'm sorry, in a way, isn't that sort of the précis of the entire DevOps, continuous integration, continuous deployment, in that you take stuff that formerly could be done in a very asynchronous, disconnected thing, and you say, no, now it's all got to be integrated and aligned. And that means groups that used to be able to go, I don't know anything about those guys, but I do my own thing, and I do it really well, and I'm proud of what I do. And all of a sudden you say, no, now you have to coordinate with that other group right. that you used to never have to talk to, except right. at the Christmas party. And all of a sudden your stuff, and even more challenging, is that you go, and by the way, you're going to be mutually measured.
Right.
So, so that's sort of, in a way, the value of doing that is manifest in that you go from months to do something to weeks or days, which has tremendous outcomes, but it requires a lot more coordination.
And I love it just because in my mind, we took something that was simple and working and we turned it complex, right, and tightly coupled. So we tried to optimize for cost and we got not cost and not speed. We got everything went poor, bad, right? So I will be happy when an architect would have smited, everyone who came up with that idea.
A question for David Cannon. So you talked about portfolio and you're managing your service portfolio. You can imagine if we move to the cloud, People can say, I want a Mongo database or Hadoop, so everybody can select their own services. And I would like to think about a similar thing as IT management. People can say, I need this automation tool, or I need this test tool for my capability. How would you be able to, because ownership and investing in IT management tools is a challenge. Who takes the decision? Who pays for it? So how do you think you would manage the portfolio of IT management solutions in the company, like a larger IT organization?
Why would IT management tools be in a portfolio separate from every other activity that we as technical professionals do?
Yeah, it should be in the same portfolio. Yeah, it's a solution.
I don't see them as being a separate entity in a portfolio. I see them as being a component of what of a capability that enables us to provide certain activities that deliver value to the company.
I agree.
That's how I would see it.
I agree, and most organizations don't manage IT management tooling as a portfolio, so they have different ownerships in the company, so it's very difficult to take decisions on, for example, somebody said we need to automate deployment.
Right, so let me go back to your initial question, which is who should architect the role of the IT manager and the management activities. The day that we in this room agree what an IT manager is, maybe we can start architecting that. But right now, we do not have an industry agreement of what a technical management professional is and what they do and how they do it. We have a lot of theories. We have a lot of frameworks, some of them official, some of them not. Some of them proprietary, some of them not. And we, as an industry, do not agree on what those are. And so, difficult to architect something when there's so much disagreement amongst the practitioners of that something. That's my first statement. And then to come back to where in the portfolio do we put IT management tools? Where would you put your assembly line?
Probably someone.
Shop floor operations.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same kind of question. It's an internal capability that we have that somebody needs to manage.
Somehow we don't plan for this capability.
But we, yeah, it's.
I don't have a problem putting them in a portfolio. I manage that portfolio. You know, and there was a marketing portfolio, and there was a retail banking portfolio, and a wholesale banking portfolio, and there was a smaller portfolios for legal and communications and HR. They all had their lead architects, and then there was a business of IT architect. And I think that Shell, Carl, I think you were that guy at Shell,
yeah.
You know. It's not that unusual. It's you know, at scale, the digital management systems are a non-trivial batch of functionality and investment. It's just arbitrary. I mean, dividing up a portfolio is kind of an arbitrary thing, you know.
This is probably obvious to everybody but me, but I was shadowing the folks at Rally Now, and they're now part of CA. And you know, the goal was I was gonna watch them do a deployment. I remember asking True and Reddy, he was a VP of R&D, a VP of operations at the time, and I asked, you know, do you use a ticketing system? Which ticketing system do you use? And I said, oh, we don't have a ticketing system. And, you know, coming from an ops background, I'm like, well, you don't have a ticketing system. It's like, you don't write anything down? It took me days to realize, oh, no, they have a ticketing system, but they're using the same backlog management ticketing as development, right? And, you know, I guess in that moment, it was just dazzling to me. It's like, oh, they have a single backlog of work, they have one place they can prioritize, you know, they can actually, when they have live site incidents, you know, all active work goes into, you know, not work, right? So everybody can work on the issue. And so I think one of the common denominators of many of the organizations coming out of DevOps Enterprise Summit is, you know, this notion of like, how do we agree on a single intake of work, right? And I just thought that was they said it was probably so important, especially when you have to balance sort of technical debt reduction. You have to see all the failure demand, and it has to be in a way that developers
absolutely.
Can digest.
Yeah, so absolutely. To standardize at least on the way you manage work, like backlogs, it could be an instant problem. The stories that you have a single backlog where all the teams can work on.
And the failure is visible to everybody in the value stream.
Right.
I'm still a little puzzled by your question as to why you would need an IT management tool portfolio.
Well, let me explain. If you look at a larger IT organization, I was working for Shell, the investment in IT management and security is large, right? And typically, there was not a single owner for IT management tooling and processes. So what every team does, they select their own tools or build a SharePoint aside to manage backlog. So before you know it, there is a sort of, everybody does it their own way, with their own set of tools, with their own set of processes. The challenge is, how do you standardize the way of working, standardize your tools without your ownership in the IT organization and manage that as a portfolio?
Oh, can I add on to the previous story? So actually, there's a gentleman from HPE. His name is Tomer Gershoni. He's responsible for security for all of the HP online services, including Fortify and all that stuff. And he said, you know, the biggest change that we've made over the last couple of years is, you know, we used to put everything in a GRC tool, right? Security info in a security tool, right? And he said, you know, we realized, you know, it might as well go to die there, right? It will, no one will act on it. It has to be in Jira or something where the developers are looking at it. If it's not in there, it will never get fixed. And I thought that was just, in my mind, just another sort of radical reorientation of where our work systems are.
Yeah, I mean, right now, and you illustrated this so well in Phoenix Project, Gene. Work arrives at the poor, hapless individual in the standard old school IT organization, at least three different channels. Fractional allocation to projects, you're gonna be 20% on this, 15%, how I spend 15% of my time on anything, I don't know. And then you got a ticketing system, and then you got stuff like John's massive 500-page Excel spreadsheet showing up via email. Now, to bring back to the operations question, I mean, you see a drill press or a CNC lathe on a shop floor. Do you have people lining up at it from three different directions and then some expeditor resolving the conflicts right there at the point of production? No, they know how work is arriving to that workstation. And sure, there are. We need to be cautious about, you know, manufacturing analogies, but right now, as you so well said, IT has a lot to learn from classic manufacturing. It's, you know, we're not ahead at all. Not when the demand is so fragmented, and that is one of the outcomes of having fragmented tool portfolios, is no overall architecture, no understanding of demand, therefore too much work in process, no flow. Yeah, we all got the t-shirt on that, where that conversation starts to go.
Let's give an opportunity in the audience to raise a question related to this topic.
So my question for you is, in the presentation this morning, David and David, you talked about the need to differentiate between value creation for those who are consuming things versus those who are producing things. As we think about IT4IT and we think about, you know, some of the conversations we just had, you know, and the standard and how we're going about looking at this problem, are we focusing on this too much? From the producer's perspective, as we look at optimizing an IT4IT tool portfolio or a process, should we be looking at optimizing it for the end user, for the consumers of these services, not for the people who are producing them?
Yeah, and I think this was my question earlier about what kind of portfolio you're trying to build. If you're trying to solve the problem of we have too many people using too many different tools, it's a management issue. That is not a value creation issue. And so you want to map value creation and how that value is realized and returned. It's a very different flow, a very different analysis than we have 50 different groups using 50 different tools, we need to get them all on the same page. They're both part of that portfolio process, but I think they do different things. They're both necessary, and so if you look at the digital business cycle, you have two cycles. One is, how do we create more value? How do we create more features, positive emotions, good customer experiences? And at the bottom end, how do we be more efficient? How do we deliver more quality? They're both very important. But I agree with you. I think you have to start with the top one, which is what are we trying to deliver into the market? What makes us unique? What brings value? And then go to the bottom and say, how do we do it? It's a different question.
Yeah, I mean, just following up on that, if we take a digital business scenario for there, you don't start the traditional way, which is what business are we in, what products do we have, what services. You start more by saying, what are we good at? What can we expose as digital touch points? What ecosystems do we take part in? What relationships do we have that we can exploit in those ecosystems? And you start designing that value for those sort of connections and those ecosystems, not for products and services. And I did sort of hold back this morning with lots of conversations still very, very product service focused. And the message we're trying to get across is now thinking of how the customer, how the, you know, the user of that actually incorporates that into an ecosystem and how they generate value by using that ecosystem.
Right, but what we're also talking about, we cannot just deliver features for the customer. We also make it manageable and make it so maybe 50% or maybe less is build features for the business or even experience or outcome. The rest is making sure that we can run and maintain those services, right? So it's a balance. We can focus on building outcome to the business, but eventually those features we also need to build in monitoring, we need to build in resilience. That's also work, right, in IT management, but typically not a business value directly.
But if I take it, again, one of the things you still see end-to-end service management where the concept is you own the end-to-end value chain and you can monitor it and you can measure it. Again, what we're trying to say here is that you don't own the end-to-end value chain. You don't actually know how the customer is constructing to get their outcome. So therefore, your role in there is as much as getting the resilience of your component, but you have to consider what the interactions are in the wider, which you may not control anymore. So the big change in mentality for IT departments is for, you know, is basically removing this boundary. You don't have a wall around everything you control. And in fact, you're not in control of it, the customer is. So how do you actually change your approach to recognize that, including the management, including the governance, including the operation, where you don't, where you're gonna effectively hand over that control?
Yeah, looking at the time, we have 1 minute left. So I want to do a sort of closure here. Imagine it's 2030, so it's 13 years from now, and you would look back, and what are the things you would laugh about that how they manage IT today, and what will be different in 2030? Like, what were the key new capabilities? What do you see different? So let me start with Charles.
I think having an understanding of the overall work, we will have a much better understanding of the work overall being imposed on the, or being directed to the IT capability as a whole.
And Gene?
I would guess, I mean, just 2 to 3 order of magnitude improvement in our productivity. You know, however we define it in terms of our ability to go from idea to actually creating value for the customer.
I think we'll be sitting there going, I can't believe that we used to think that humans were going to design and run this, as opposed to some AI system that basically keeps track of all this and gives us an optimized plan and executes it. And we'll all sit around drinking Mai Tais going, well, that was a big waste of time that we used to do, wasn't it?
Thanks. David?
So I think the biggest change from us is just the increased diversity of the technology. So if we look at cloud now and where it's going, we're still at only the first step. You know, it's still relatively new. We're only taking really the first step. So if you start continuing to abstract what the concepts are and going further and further away as the functional type of architectures go, you're going to see lots and lots more capability. And as AI gets out there, as Internet of Things, you're just going to see technology embedded in everything. So when I look back and thinking now is that we really thought cloud was the next best thing? Well, it's that was just the little step out of the data center.
And David?
13 years, I think we're gonna see so much innovation, but I think some of the things are still gonna be the same. I think you're still always gonna have technology people focused on managing technology, whatever form that takes. And I think it's going to be a different technology, but there'll still be a lot of a technology focus in some groups. Challenge will still be, how do we overcome the technocentric view in favor of a bigger picture? I think in 13 years, we're still not going to have solved that one.
And we'll still be using Visio.
Yeah, I'm right.
But just a final question.
Visio from my cold dead fingers.
Gene, just a final question for you. What just thinking of, what if the Phoenix project had IT4IT as a reference architecture, how to run a modern IT function? Would that help them in their journey?
Yeah, no, I think, as Charlie so astutely points out, I mean, so much of it was all about work intake, and to be able to normalize it against a common language, right? Say, independent of what the work is for, you know, it's going to flow through these work centers, and you know, it needs to get prioritized, scheduled, executed, etc. I mean, that it would be a tremendous help. Trouble is, it'd be a much smaller book.
I praise indeed.
Okay, thank you very much for being a panel here. Please, as well.
All right. Thank you.